Hallelujah.
Friends, it's wonderful to be with you this morning as we gather as God's people to worship Him in this continuing Easter season of joy. Just in case you're wondering who that strange person at the front is, my name's Malcolm. I'm the Archdeacon of Sheffield and Rotherham. So I've already joked with one or two people that are about to get my passport out this morning, but that's not true, really. But one of the joys that I have as a member of the Bishop's Senior Staff Team is to be worshipping with God's people in different places each Sunday. So it's wonderful to be a visitor with you, to welcome you to your church. And if you are a visitor here this morning too, then please do come and say hello to me afterwards, and I know I'm not on my own as a visitor, but you're very welcome to join in as much as you're able in today's worship. As we recognise God's presence with us by His Holy Spirit, we join together in saying, Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil, and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. Together we pray. Almighty God,
our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in the newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Jesus Christ, have overcome death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life. Grant that, as by your grace going before us, you put into our minds good desires, so by your continual help, we may bring them to good effect. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Now upon your written word, that you send us the gift of your Holy Spirit to receive the words you have for us today, that we may behold the living word, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, please do sit. You may have heard the one-liner joke, how many Anglicans does it take to change a light bulb? The answer, change? What do you mean, change? You see, we're not great at change, are we? And yet, as followers of Jesus, we are caught up in mission to an ever-changing world, which will more than likely require us to be an ever-changing church. And that's before we factor in the challenges of limited resources and the need to think differently about how we allocate them. Here at Doncaster Minster, you don't need me to tell you that change is afoot as you plan for the appointment of a new vicar, as you consider how you might work more closely with neighbouring churches to bring the good news of Jesus to this ever-changing city of Doncaster. The opportunities are exciting and far-reaching, but change can also be unsettling. Our gospel reading this morning is taken from what is widely referred to as Jesus' farewell discourse, where in chapters 14 to 17 of his gospel, John recounts the teaching that Jesus gave to his disciples following the Last Supper and immediately before his arrest. Given the timing and the significant changes that his followers will be facing in the near future, it seems pretty likely that Jesus would have focused his teaching on things of real importance, the things that he wanted his closest followers to remember as they faced the emotional roller coaster of the days ahead, seeking to remain as his witnesses through all the changes that were to come. For us, 2,000 years later, Jesus' words are probably quite familiar. But for his first disciples, this would have been new teaching. And over the next 10 minutes or so, I'd like to consider these verses under three headings: a new inclusion, a new transformation, and a new purpose. So firstly, a new inclusion. In these verses, Jesus indicates where his followers truly belong, where our real home is as Christians. And it's not in a location or a physical place built with bricks and mortar, not even in one as significant as this Minster church. Instead, Jesus spoke passionately about our need to remain or to abide in him. That word abide literally means to reside or live in. In other words, for the Christian, Jesus is where we live. He is where we truly belong. And Jesus illustrated this with an image that may be a little bit lost on some of us, especially those who, like me, don't do much gardening. The nearest I get to tending vines is when I remove the cork and pour the fruit of the vine into a glass. But for Jesus' hearers, vines were a powerful and hugely significant theological symbol. In the Old Testament, Israel is continually referred to as God's vine, conveying an image of God's purpose. Vines were highly valued signs of prosperity and peace, and so Israel, as God's vine, was charged with spreading shalom, peace, wholeness, by calling all nations to follow the one true God. With all of that firmly in the background of the disciples' Jewish faith, Jesus announced, "I am the true vine." It's the last of his seven I am statements throughout John's Gospel, and at this particular moment, it would have had a profound resonance for his disciples. They would have heard this startling claim as Jesus declaring that where Israel had failed up to live to its calling, he was the one who would fulfill all that they were meant to be, the true vine. Jesus was introducing here a seismic shift in theological understanding, Inclusion in God's people was no longer a matter of belonging to a particular nation, but of belonging to a person, Jesus, the true vine, into whom all people can be gathered and can belong. Nobody is excluded from this new vine, not by nationality, race, status, gender, sexuality, lack of wealth, or anything else. As we read the New Testament, we see how this understanding begins to permeate the early church. In this morning's reading from Acts chapter 8, we read about the Ethiopian eunuch being baptized by Philip, making it clear that race and ethnicity is no barrier to full inclusion in the body of Christ. In Acts chapter 10, Peter received a deeply subversive vision, which resulted in him baptizing Cornelius, a Gentile convert to Christ. St. Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, carried the good news of Christ abroad, even to Europe, and discovered that there is no longer Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female, for all, he writes, are one in Christ Jesus. Everyone is included. Anyone who wants to belong to Jesus and remain in him is part of this new vine that stretches to the ends of the earth. Friends, this is the heart of the Christian gospel, the good news that the limitless love of God revealed in the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Jesus extends to everyone. In this is love, we heard in this morning's other reading. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. But hang on a minute. What about the first half of verse 2 in our gospel reading, where Jesus tells us that the Father, the vine grower, removes every branch that bears no fruit? There may well be a new inclusion that extends to all people, but this sounds a little bit like exclusion, doesn't it? So maybe it needs a bit of unpacking. Thankfully, Jesus did that for us in verses 4 to 8. For there, Jesus explained that the branches that bear no fruit, the ones that are removed, are those that do not abide in the vine. The biblical scholar George Beeson Murray points out that the sense of the repeated phrase, abide in me, is step into union with me. I love that. The call of Jesus in these verses is to step into union with him, knowing that he is in union with us. The branches that bear no fruit are those that are not in union with Jesus. And as verse 4 makes clear, we can no more expect them to be fruitful for Christ as we can a branch that is separated from its vine bear fruit. It's a stark and obvious illustration. Jesus is not saying that non-Christians cannot do good things, and he's not placing limits on the gospel's inclusion. What he is doing is reshaping our priorities. The branches that bear no fruit are removed from the vine by the vine grower, God the Father. But the branches that bear no fruit are those already not in union with the vine, with Jesus, those detached from the vine. That's why they're not bearing fruit for the kingdom. The picture Jesus paints here is not of a judgmental gardener who wrenches branches off the vine because they're not good enough, but of a tending vine grower who simply removes the dead wood from around the living vine so that it may live even more fruitfully. Even so, it does stand as a challenge to us, doesn't it? In this new inclusion, are we living in union with Jesus? Do we abide in him as our home, seeing him as our number one priority? And is this evidence in the fruit that we bear for the kingdom of God? That's my first point. You'll be pleased to know my next two are much shorter. See, secondly, in these verses, we find a new transformation. Being a branch in the vine is not always a comfortable thing. By stepping into union with Jesus, by abiding in him, we align ourselves with God's values, with God's priorities for the world that God created. We're called to work for the coming of God's kingdom, and at times this may make life difficult for us. It may bring us into conflict with the values of those around us. It may lead to internal conflict when our own lives don't match up to the kingdom principles we profess. Having spoken of the vine grower removing the deadwood in the first part of verse 2, Jesus went on to say this: every branch that bears fruit, God prunes. And why? To make it bear even more fruit. God's pruning, those times when we feel that it's difficult, the painful experiences in our Christian journey, can in themselves be evidence that we are on the right track, that we are in union with Jesus. Because it's those who are bearing fruit who are pruned by the vine grower. And the purpose, so that we can be even more fruitful, even more effective in growing the kingdom of God in an increasingly close union with the vine. We are pruned, shaped, formed as followers of Jesus as we study the Bible, as we meet together, so that we better reflect the vine in whom we abide. I don't know about you, but I'm a little bit of a hoarder. I am not great at throwing things away, even when I've done with them. There could be things in my house that I've not looked at for 5 years and yet I still won't throw them away. And that's probably the main reason why I really don't enjoy moving house. Unfortunately, whenever I change my job, I have to move house, so it's something I have to go through. My wife, Jo, actually quite likes moving house. She enjoys planning how each room will look, and she thrives on the opportunity to throw away loads of the stuff that we've accumulated that we no longer need. So you can see why I don't enjoy it all that much. But if I'm honest, and please don't tell Jo this, I have to admit that this pruning is actually quite a good thing. It can be quite therapeutic. As we strip away the clutter that we've built up, often I rediscover the things that we own that are of real value, that I've forgotten that we even owned. And it's a little bit like that in our lives with God. God is in the business of transformation, of gently and graciously changing us to be more the people He created us to be, pruning away the clutter, if you like, to bring to the fore what is of real value. Friends, I wonder, what might God want to prune from your life at the moment? What might He want you to declutter from, so as to rediscover the things of true value? And these questions are just as relevant for us as a church gathered together, especially in times of change. Might there be things here in St. George's that God wants to prune away, so that you are better able to bring the good news of God's love to the people of this city, to see Doncaster transformed by the love of Jesus? Because, as I close, Jesus spoke thirdly of a new purpose for those who step into union with Him. In verse 8, we read, "My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples." Our purpose as followers of Jesus is to bear much fruit for the kingdom, to be His disciples. I love the way that Eugene Peterson translates Jesus' words in Matthew 5. "You're here to be light, bringing out the God colours in the world." What a wonderful illustration. But if we live up to our calling, people will glimpse the values of God in our lives. In our diocese, we long to see every follower of Jesus rediscover their calling to be a light for Christ, receiving Christ's light as His friends, walking in Christ's light as His followers, reflecting Christ's light to those around us. That's the purpose that we are called to when we step into union with Jesus through baptism, to be disciples who bear fruit as we live in relationship with Him Sunday through to Saturday, Sunday through to Saturday. And that's what I love the most about this picture of the true vine. To illustrate the Christian life, Jesus chose to adopt a living, organic image. Following Jesus is not supposed to be lifeless and rules-based. It's not an exam to be passed, but a relationship to be lived. And St. Paul describes the church similarly as a body, an organic unit, alive and growing, cell by cell, with each part vital to the whole. Friends, welcome to the New Testament picture of the Church of Jesus Christ. Not a traditional organization, but a dynamic, living, changing organism. The community of those who abide in Jesus and know that he abides in them. May that be true of us and of this minister church in all the changes that lie ahead, so that we may bear much fruit for the kingdom of God. Amen.
Comfortable doing so, would you stand with me and let us declare our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father
the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things made. For us and our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered the death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
And so, in joy and hope, let us pray to the Father.
Almighty God, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find rest in you. Sovereign God, you are faithful to us through all the storms of life. May you continue to help us and strengthen us in our faith, so that we may serve you faithfully and with love. Grant that the Church may hold fast to her rule, so that all her branches may grow together in faith and service, and especially through this time of interregnum. Counsel her, protect her from all that hinders her mission, and purify her to bring forth the fruit of the Spirit, of the Gospel. We thank you for our priests who faithfully administer the sacraments, for our bishops and all clergy helping in this diocese. We pray for King Charles and Catherine, the Princess of Wales at this time. thanks for the gift of your word, the grace of the sacraments, and the fellowship of your people. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Compassionate God, we pray for peace, justice, and reconciliation throughout the world, for the honouring of human rights and the relief of the oppressed. We pray for the outcasts of the world, those put off from their families, rejected by society, and lost hope of no return. We hold up to the escalating situation in the Middle East, for the situation between Iran and Israel, for the people suffering in Gaza, for those who are still held hostage. We pray that more humanitarian aid will get through to the people of Gaza. We continue to pray also for the people of Ukraine, where there is abuse of power, where there is hostility between nations. Bring healing and a new spirit so that they all know and may live in harmony, rooted in love. We hold up to the homeless and the vulnerable, refugees and those in prison. We long for more support for our National Health Service, for care homes and hospices, for our ambulance, fire and emergency services, for our peace. We pray for those affected by severe tornadoes in some parts of America at the moment. We remember those who make important decisions that affect the life of our planet, for those who do research and healing and renewal of the earth. Inspire us to continue your work of reconciliation today. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Loving God, we hold up to you our families, friends and neighbours. For young people growing up in today's world, for the bewildered and the seeking, that they may find faith in you. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious God, stretch out your hand to bring wholeness and peace to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Pray for Isabel, Roger, Canon Christopher, Veronica, Daphne, Isabel, and Arlie. Fill us with compassion that we may become channels of your healing love. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord God, we remember before you those whom we love but see no longer. We pray for the recently departed and for James Barry Collins, Ella Margaret Cook, Ian David Watt, Alvin John Clark Jr., Alice Walton, Pearl Rose Smith, and Ernest Dilks, whose anniversary occurs at this time. Help us to live this day in the sure and certain hope of your eternal victory. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Faithful God, whose promises stand sure forever, we thank you for your patience and your refusal to give up on us. We pray in the name of Christ, the true God. Merciful Father,
before doing so, please stand with me. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So sensitive to one another, let's offer a sign of our peace we enjoy in Christ.
present, be present, Lord Jesus Christ, our risen High Priest. Make yourself known in the breaking of bread. Amen. The Lord be with you.
The Lord be with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father. And in these days of Easter, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful works. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell, and restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise, and opened to them the gate of life eternal. And so, in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and the powers of all creation sing forever the hymn of your glory. Again, he praised you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection. Great is the mystery of faith. Joining our voices with followers of Jesus right across this diocese of Sheffield and throughout the world, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us.
Eternal God, whose Son Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, grant us to walk in this way, to rejoice in his truth, and to share his risen life, who is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. Together we pray. Father,
we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We who the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Friends, please do sit as we hear some notices.
On your behalf, Archdeacon Martin for leading our worship this morning. Thank you very much. Very nice earlier in the week to receive a very nice card from Bishop Pete, who wishes to send the Lord his best wishes for our future. I hope that everything is going well here at the Westminster Fellows House here. As May very quickly approaches, we've got a number of things going on. There are a number of services outlined on the new sheet, including all those for the season of Thy Kingdom Come, which are the daily acts of worship between Ascension Day and Pentecost, so they are all outlined in there. On Saturday the 18th of May, we are hosting the Dr. Degree Mother's Union Coffee Morning. That is open to all, and many of you can attend, that would be appreciated. And then from the 25th to the 30th of May, on the East Road, we have got the Festival of Colour, which is organised by Ruos, who organised the Festival of Light in November. And as well as the Festival of Colour, there are a number of other attractions that are taking place, and there are leaflets on the table at the back which you can take away, and it tells you how you can book half-hourly slots to come and well, that should be a wonderful thing as well. But that is all for now. Please stand and we
the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you this day and always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.